So I'm gonna talk about some of the solos, some of the guitar material that influenced me when I was initially learning, when I was growing up, basically. It's a kind of response video. There's a channel called Dave's Guitar Channel on YouTube, and he did a video a month ago or so. The 11 best solos that influenced me, or, you know, something of that nature. I don't know why 11 seems a pretty odd number. And it's not surprising, really, because Dave is probably the same age as me. I'm 50 now. I am. And a lot of the stuff he was talking about, I was going, yeah. Because, I mean, you talk to other musicians about stuff and they go, oh no, I don't know that one. And particularly when it comes to things like Elliot Easton from The Cars, Larry Carlton from Steely Dan's the Royal Scam album, and Michael Schenker has come up as well quite a few times. And he talks about Judas Priest and early John Roth, and I was never into that kind of black leather and studs type metal, the Scorpions or whatever, except to say that I saw Michael Schenker play live a few times as part of MSG after UFO and after he was in the Scorpions, and I was blown away. This lunatic on stage with a Gibson Flying V, and he was playing stuff that really was streets ahead of anyone else I'd seen at that time. I used to go to it during the 80s. I went to a lot of gigs. Anytime a band came into town that I wanted to see, we got tickets, we went to see it. So, I mean, I'm talking about people like saw Whitesnake, Rainbow, Gillen, when Purple had split up and reformed. They had the band Gillen, which we saw a few times. I saw John Sykes with Whitesnake, and a lot of really influential guitar players came in and out of that equation. And I found Schenker to be monstrously good in terms of what he was doing, and you know, at that time, it seems like everybody else was just bashing away at pentatonic solos, and Schenker was doing something else. I mean, Richie Blackmore obviously was doing that too. But at the time I saw Rainbow was in the Royal Court Theatre in Liverpool. Jolene Turner was the singer that day. And I don't think Richie played a note. There was a lot of this stuff going on. Doing all this kind of thing, and every now and again he'd chuck in a bit of a kind of thing, but there was nothing there. There was none of the Blackmore pyrotechnics that you'd come to expect. And I was really disappointed. And there was actually in the local paper in the Liverpool Echo the next day, there was an article explaining that he was apologising because he had a bad back on the night. I noticed he kept, during the gig, he kept moving backwards on his heels like this. So probably that's true. But there you go. So anyway, I'm going to talk about some of the solos that had a big influence on me. I can't really pin it down to 11. So I'm going to kind of generalise with regards to the artist in question or the guitarist in question. And it doesn't really come in any particular order, because I'd probably say in the same way that Dave did, that the main influence was Jimmy Page. And Jimmy Page was in this kind of unusual genre of successful rock star, because he'd been a session player, as Richie was in the 60s. So he kind of cut his trade. He learned his trade on the job. I mean, obviously he could play. I'm assuming he could also read. And I know from what I've read and what I've seen that Richie was doing something similar. Richie would get to walk in a room and they'd say, this artist is just going to sing. Here's your chord chart. And 1, 2, 3, off we go. Okay, so anyway, I'm going off on a tangent. So the first one I'm going to talk about that you don't hear much about these days is Frank Marino. I remember getting an album. We had a record player, or a music centre as it was called then. You could play tapes. You could play the radio through it, and you could play the vinyl. You know, your records. And one of the records that came into the house, I don't know where, why, or how, but Frank Marino and Mahogany Rush Live. It's just black with it's a single album, and it's just a few blues rock tracks on it. It sounds like they're playing, if you listen to the record, it sounds like they're playing in a huge stadium, but I'm assuming that it wasn't. I think he's Canadian, and there's a track on there called King B, where he plays this kind of ballady, slowed down jazz blues, and it's fabulous stuff. I've heard Zach Wilde mention it on more than one occasion too. It's one of those albums that you just keep going back to and listening to over and over again. I've had it on vinyl, I've had it on CD. I find it difficult to listen to it all the way through these days because I've heard it so many times. But that kind of jazzy blues guitar style, it's still there with me now. I can't really it's really melodic. One of the real big names of 70s American music, Ry Cooder. And I came across Ry Cooder for the simple reason, I mean, I was into Little Feat, and that kind of slide guitar style was very appealing. And I tried to learn slide guitar. I bought this book called the Mickey Baker Book of Slide Blues Guitar, and it wasn't much fun because there was a lot of the old kind of tune it to E. Thank you. appeal to me that much at the time. But then I was what we were watching one Saturday night. I remember it well. I must have been about, I don't know, 12 or 13, sitting there with my dad and my brother. This film comes on, Paris, Texas, and this slide guitar. I couldn't wait to the end of the film to see what the credits were, to see who played the guitar on it. And obviously it was Ry Cooder, but it's just absolutely immense. I've got the soundtrack CD somewhere as well, so that's Ry Cooder. And leading on from that, in a similar sort of vein, was that one of the things about I love the Clint Eastwood films, the old Clint Eastwood. Just had a fabulous feel to it. It's inspirational music. Ennio Morricone, I think his name is, the composer. So, why Schenker anyway? There's an album called Live at the Budokan with Gary Barden singing it. Are you ready to walk? I think it's just called MSG Live at the Budokan. It was somewhere around about 82, 83, and that was the era that we saw him in. There was a big difference between the first time we saw Schenker, a big noticeable difference in Michael Schenker's appearance in between the first time.
Hello Tokyo! MSG, arm and ready!
I saw him live on the last time, and he didn't, he certainly didn't improve, but his guitar playing was fabulous. The first time, I was just absolutely blown away, but seeing Schenker play the way he did was just phenomenal. The Courvoisier Concerto was just something you would never... you couldn't have imagined it at the time. It was just it's kind of gut-wrenching piece of music that's indicative of the type of frame of mind he got himself into when he was when he was drinking in a negative mindset, because he obviously had drink problems. There's a little aside to that. My old bass player, in the last good band I was in, he was the bass player, and he said I met Michael Schenker. Well, we went to see him play live one night. It was probably one of the gigs I saw him at, and they got into the bar after the show that Schenker had gone into. So I went up to Michael Schenker to ask him, just with the intention of striking up some sort of conversation with him, as you know, one musician to another. And he went up to Schenker and said, what sort of strings do you use? And Schenker being the individual that he is, he said metal ones, and that was the end of that. Cut him dead. So here's a clip from the Live at the Budokan. There's a load of songs I could choose from, but I'm going to go for this one. when you listen to Schenker, you can hear that is the kind of his style is the forerunner to, you know, what the likes of Satriani and Vi did a few years later, and maybe Malmsteen. I mean, I know Malmsteen was heavily into the Baroque style playing, but he's quoting Bach a lot, but Johann Sebastian Bach, I should say. But there's still that sense that Schenker got there first. I mean, I think I've seen an AC/DC documentary where apparently Angus Young and Bon Scott said that's the band when they saw UFO with Schenker. That's the band we're gonna stylize ourselves upon. So Bon Scott styled himself as in the same way as Pete Way was the front man, and Angus was that kind of charismatic lead guitar player, although Angus ran around the stage dressed as a schoolboy with boundless energy. So that's Schenker. So I remember seeing Rory twice. He came to Liverpool loads of times, but we saw him in the university halls, Manford Hall, and we were probably 12 feet from the stage. I don't remember that much about the gig. I remember he played a lot of slide that night, and then we saw him again later on, a couple of years later, with the same band, Jerry McAvoy on the bass. I can't remember who the drummer was. There wasn't as much lead in it this time, and there was a lot of the best track on the album. Maybe my taste have changed now, but I distinctly remember the first time putting the album on. You know, when you took the album out of the sleeve and you looked at all the pictures and read the bump on the sleeve, and putting the album on. For a long time I just played, and then I go to the C7, and it's always bugging me that there was something not quite right. I just did that one day, and it's like, thank God for that. What's the name of the song? Follow Me. The song Follow Me. And there was a lot of stuff from an album that we had called Top Priority, and there was no slide. It was a lot less slide, a lot less acoustic, and it was a proper rock gig that night. And what marks that night is that halfway through the gig, that all of the power went. I remember it just went pitch black, and all you could hear were the drummer just carried on, and then there was a couple of beams of light as roadies come in from the side. And you could just make out the generator, and an AC-30 was wheeled into the stage from one side, a generator from another, and there was a couple of lights. By this time, I'm assuming that it was safety lights to come on back on a battery system, and it was just a fairly bald looking stage, because that's what the stages are, black. With no lights, there's not much to look at, but you could make out what was going on. And Rory was standing there. Well, one roadie plugged his guitar into the AC-30. Another roadie plugged the generator into the AC-30. And Rory just carried on with the drummer. A few minutes later, all the lights came back on, and then they were back through the PA, and that was it. But another player with boundless energy, Rory Gallagher, running around the stage like Angus in his younger days anyway. And so anyway, I was talking about the album Top Priority, and I has mentioned a few times Elliot Easton, and the Cars is one of those bands you can never talk about, because no matter how many musos you come across, and they'll know just what I needed. And I had that album for, I don't know why, I think I used to listen to the track on the radio, and eventually they stopped playing it on the radio, and I went and bought the album, and Best Friend's Girl is on there, I can't remember what else. But that solo and Just What I Needed, I thought that was like, where did that come from? Because everyone plays it that little bit differently, isn't it? But I always played it there. Old habits die hard, but it's just the fact, I think it's the kind of chromatic movement you get, because they've gone from the E to the D sharp, so he uses those from the E to the B, and the B chord includes that D sharp, so Elliot uses that. That movement in his solo. So where we've got wasting all my time. So when we get that C sharp minor to G sharp, the G sharp includes a C. So Elliot plays a C, which you wouldn't expect, because most of the solo is in this kind of E major pentatonic. He just struck me as always looking one notch better than everyone else, because he had that Telecaster and he played left-handed, and just something about him. His solos have got that real perfect feel about them. He just nails that maybe 8 or 16 bars that he gets to play a solo, and with something that is memorable enough, you know, for you to boost the song in such a way that you want to go back and listen to it again.